Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the TI6 European Qualifier Playoffs. We have Alliance versus Team Adfinim, and we are hopping into game number two of this best of three. Alliance take down Adfinim in game number one on the back of a Wisp Tiny with a load of Bristleback, a Bulldog Batrider, just kind of being the enforcers, building up so much momentum from the laning phase and continuing to kind of neuter down Adfinim and prevent them from really flourishing into the late game, where potentially their Tricore could have been a problem fogged, but they were not able to get to that point. And, well, here we are, game number two. What do you think, man?
Yeah, you touched on it up on it really well. Alliance's lane setup was really good that game, and like I mentioned, they just dictated the pace of the game. They just directed the whole flow of that game, and it was just purely in their basket that entire through all the stages that happened. So, and I really want to point out just how well S4 actually played that game. We've been seeing him maybe struggle a little bit, but that game, it was back to the S4 that we love to see. He was all over the place, active, landing every single combination, landing all of his spells properly, and making really good like setups with Bulldog. So both those guys, in my opinion, played very well that last game. Coming up now, we look at the bans and the picks. Pretty much what we wanted to see. I think this is what I wanted to see last game, especially the Wisp ban. I thought Adfinim would have banned the Wisp versus Alliance last game, but they didn't. Now it's Alliance banning out the Wisp, and then Adfinim, of course, banning out the Batrider. They don't want to have to deal with that again since Alliance looked so dominant with it last game.
And they go with a pretty traditional first pick, a solid Darkseer here, not going wavering away for anything like the Elder Titan once more. Just feel pretty confident that Darkseer just brings so much, of course. If you had to pick a hero that was probably the most well-rounded in the game, I would put Darkseer in that group, but do you think there's anyone who's just always a great well-rounded pick in any situation?
Radiant team pick.
Yeah, Darkseer's pretty
he's
good.
He's one
for
of
that.
Them, you know.
Yeah, he's up there.
He's got a little bit of everything, you know.
It's like Lion, Darkseer.
Yeah.
You know, like those guys like fit every situation.
Some may make an argument for this hero here, Earth Spirit.
Yes.
Maybe me, because I'm pretty biased about it. But
well, yeah, the hero. You look at him and he goes, "Wow, this hero does everything except for physical damage."
Yeah. And just offering your silence, your stun, your magnetize. I mean, already huge team fight potential just between the 1-2 punch here of Adfinim. Vacuum magnetize, vacuum or boulder smash. We saw it a lot even during the Shanghai Major. So we'll see if they're going to have any luck with it. On the side of Alliance, though, they're going to just open up already with both of their supports. They get the Witch Doctor and go right for the Ricky. And not every team enjoys having to play that Ricky game and against a Ricky.
He just forces you to expend a lot of resources. However, this is not a Ricky Lifestealer. We've been seeing Lifestealer completely fall out of the meta again.
Why would you think that is?
I don't know. That's some games it seems like he still can work really well, but it just seems people are just completely staying away from the hero. It seems like we're back to our Juggernauts, we're back to our Voids. However, Adfinim, they don't want to deal with the Ricky Lifestealer. That is one of those combinations that is just too potent. It puts too much pressure on the map, and they just don't want to deal with it, so they just ban it.
If anyone was to still pull out the Lifestealer, it'd probably be Alliance too, though. So maybe it's for the safe bet that Adfinim do get rid of it just in case here. And
it's really good versus Darkseer and Earth Spirit as well. Obviously, with the Rage making you immune to all spell damage.
Alliance actually ban out the Disruptor here. They follow up with another second phase Respect ban on that very scary Madara Slark.
Same third, fourth bans from Alliance.
Yeah.
And we are actually back to our norm as well. We did see Adfinim. They are first pick on Radiant this time, and it's second pick on Dire. Last game, like we mentioned, it was, I think, Adfinim chose Radiant, and they had
second pick, right?
Second pick.
Yeah, very awkward there. But, well, they paid the price, maybe. I wouldn't put it all on that, of course. But, unfortunately, now this means that they will be at a bit of a disadvantage here, being one match down. And Alliance, as mentioned before, just that one win away from being able to secure their invite to Seattle and competing at TI6.
Yeah. To clarify, just to make sure that people understand what we're saying with that too, is that they will make it to if Alliance wins this game, they do make it to TI guaranteed. Mm-hmm. But they need to win the next series to actually be playing in TI. It'll be for the wild card spot, of course.
Yeah,
The two teams that make it to the grand finals do make it, but one does go to the wild card,
of course. But hey, they get to go to Seattle.
Yes, they get to go to Seattle.
We'll have to see if they're going to be able to just kind of be automatically in the tournament, or like you mentioned, battle their way through that very scary wild card or not. So
wild card's no joke, man. That's
Didn't you have to play in a wild card?
Yeah.
I think I remember even playing a wall card, and unfortunately back then, Valve wasn't nice enough to allow every team to play on the mighty main stage.
No, and it was sad. Those are sad days. We won't go get into that.
Yeah. But you can relate, you know. Yeah. Not a team would rather be there first and foremost. Wild card is not the easiest thing to make your way out from. So second phase, though, at Finn, I'm really thinking about this one here. You know you're going against the Ricky Witch Doctor, and you've already committed for the Darkseer here, so you can't get yourself like a creepy Slardar, let's say, or anything like that to help kind of detect the Ricky. So they really need to kind of see where they want to go with this here.
Yeah, it's just probably looking. They're probably just like glancing at like what recently Alliance has played, what they've been synergizing with the Witch Doctor, with the Ricky. Don't think we've actually seen the Ricky too much, so they're probably just looking at what Alliance likes specifically with the Witch Doctor, which is, I mean, the standard from which they do. Which I wouldn't be surprised. Maybe a Juggernaut ban. We see a lot of people running the Juggernaut into the Earth Spirit Darkseer, but now it is actually a Timbersaw ban. So I'm assuming Alliance will just pick up the Jug here.
Do we know Alliance to play a lot of Timbersaw? I haven't seen a whole lot of like S4 Timber or even Bulldog Timber in recent history. I don't mean to put you on the spot as you frantically.
No. I was just tab to see. I didn't think so either. I think maybe we'd seen one game of it, but no, I am mistaken. They had not played any Timbersaw.
Yeah.
And like I said,
instantly nice call,
picked
sir.
The Juggernaut. Yeah, it's people have been picking it like constantly versus this Darkseer and Earth Spirit, just because you can't get. Obviously, you can't roll on him. You can't Ion Shell pressure him because he can just spin and kind of walk away. And it synergizes as well. It's Healing Ward. It's more with the Witch Doctor heal. And it's Alliance. This is a very safe and general pick for them.
Oh, absolutely. And could prevent FNM from certain pickups here. It looks like they will round out their secondary support with the other well-rounded hero we were talking about, Fog.
Darkseer and Lion.
If you couldn't have any two better well-rounded heroes, it's Darkseer and Lion. And Advinim will be able to snag up both.
They have all three of the most well-rounded heroes.
You're right.
As I mentioned, Darkseer and Spirit
Lion. Now, who's the most well-rounded core?
Now we need some physical damage, Advinim. Let's go.
I mean, first thing I think about is Sven, but I don't know how much Sven I've been seeing recently. Typically a very good powerhouse duo with something like the Darkseer.
He's great versus all three of the heroes that Alliance has. The Sven pick would be really cool, and Madara had a huge impact. We're back.
The son of Magnus.
We're back to the S4 mag. So they have obviously the Empower for the Juggernaut, and they even have the Empower for the Ricky. So we have been seeing, not lately at all, of course, and maybe only in pub games, but you've seen that Battle Fury Ricky, right? You see how much damage it actually does with Tricks of the Trade because it does cleave.
Oh
so
my
we
God.
Could even see him transition. If it is a Ricky support with Empower, he can actually get very farmed.
Oh, goodness. Okay.
So there's the physical damage that we were asking for.
Was it Advinim? I was casting a game with Merlini the other day, and I think it was Advinim who tried to pull out a TA in a difficult matchup against Secret, I believe, in the mid lane Timbersaw. And it looked like it was working out at first. Was it not them?
They have two TA games that they played recently.
Yeah, maybe it was that one against Fantastic Five? No, I'm not too sure. Or no, Vega Squadron maybe. They tried to match up. They've been trying to match up TA against the mid lane Timber in those cases, and it started out pretty strong. And then you were expecting the snowball follow up, but it didn't really quite get there. But hey, this time it looks like it will be Timber versus, or sorry, TA versus the Magnus.
And Alliance agrees with us. They ban this fan. It is actually the perfect hero for Advinim to. Like, do everything. Like, Ricky can't really gank his lane too well, obviously, because of the Warcry, and Sven's just such a tanky hero. Warcry versus Juggernaut is extremely good, and extremely good versus Witch Doctor. Everything about the Sven would have been, like, the perfect pick. And you kind of maybe are looking at Anfina and maybe like, oh, man, maybe they should have picked the Sven fourth instead of the Templar Assassin.
Yeah. I mean, I guess maybe they just wanted to get, like, what they felt would be the absolute best matchup in the mid lane, but you're
12
right.
12 seconds now, and they go for the safe lane carry void.
Very interesting. Okay.
We've actually seen a couple teams do this, especially when they have a Darkseer, just because of the synergy with the vacuum into the Chrono stuff.
Yeah.
But also, your Void doesn't need too many items to get solo kills. He can just have an Ion Shell on him, and it amplifies his damage quite a lot.
Nonetheless, this already looks like it's going to be a potential for a very exciting game. I didn't get such extra base on the Magnus pick, but I'm always a big fan because he's just such a crowd pleaser. RPs just bring the hype, and you got that together with your vacuum walls, your Earth Spirit magnetizes, Chronos. This game is going to have a lot of fireworks. And
so we have the Bulldog Lone Druid is still left in the pool if they want to go for something like that. It is a lot of synergy with the Juggernaut, and it also benefits from Empower. Trying to think of heroes that really benefit from that, so they can go for their like tri or even quad core for Alliance.
Outside of that,
there's Beastmaster that they. Oh no, sorry, that Beastmaster is definitely banned. Apologies.
No worries. Beastmaster's out. Brood's obviously out. Batrider's gone.
Salute, Druid. I mean, you're just kind of going down.
Got him.
You're feeling it. This one.
Got him.
We got it. We're feeling it. And you know, maybe something that Adfinim should have been expecting here, but nonetheless, we see our five-man draft here fogged on paper. Who do you got?
They've had pretty. Adfinim's had a lot of success with the safe lane void, but I'm. This is such a staple Alliance draft. I feel like we
always say that, it's always easy to say that with an Alliance draft because they don't reach too far outside the box.
Yeah.
But that's just a nice thing. Alliance has been playing together so long. They have those lineups. They're always going to end up with one of them. And the next thing you know, you're saying, this feels like an Alliance lineup.
The one thing for Alliance, I guess, that they lack is the Lone Druid takes some time to build up. And Ricky wants to be able to gank the lanes. But he doesn't really have the best option right now in
that's
the game
true.
To be ganking them. So they could fall behind, especially if they have to play like a play with four heroes and let the Lone Druid do his own thing. So we'll see how they decide to adapt for that and what they want to prepare. But Adfinim as well, these heroes need their levels. Darkseer requires his farm. He needs to get like levels. He needs to get his mech up relatively early. Earth Spirit as well needs some levels. Lion is probably the one who needs levels the least on this team. But yeah, across the board of Adfinim, it's a little bit greedy. But Alliance's draft as well is a little greedy, but it just takes, not greedy so much, but it takes some time to just progress onto what they want. And they're going to do what they've been doing actually so often now. They're doing a pseudo aggro with the Juggernaut and Witch Doctor and maybe even the Ricky moving down to that safe lane and putting Bulldog in that 1v1 situation.
They've been
giving him farm.
Doing it a lot with like that Dazzle Rubick combo they've been pulling out from time to time, but it just seems like a trending thing now. And I guess when they feel like they've been pulling in a lot of success with it, why not go back for it once more? Quickly fly through some of these fancy little predictions here. The highest total magic or pure damage. I will put that potentially on, I don't know, I'll just go load up for that one. How long will the game be? Ooh, that's a decent question. Could be decently long.
Magic or pure damage, remember, not physical. So.
Oh, magic or pure. Okay, I will go.
I got you.
What are you going to do?
You got 12 seconds. I just picked randomly. I did Skylar.
Right, holy shit. I'm just going to... If I win that somehow, that's going to be amazing. Anyways, as we get underway here, Madara scoping out this bottom lane along with Thug. And maybe next time we could see an early rumble
nice
here.
Stun.
Good little stun. Gets the setup. But Thug eating a lot of damage here from the Blade Fury. He's going to force out the boulder roll. And
saves
it comes
his
up
life.
Just a bit short. Refraction's going to come out. And that refraction will not be enough. First blood goes to Loda. It's a ravage of a stun coming out for maybe next time, but it doesn't matter as the damage had been done fogged. Of all the people
pause.
To go down, it's the Thug TA, and from all the people to get the first blood for Alliance, it's Loda.
Yeah.
Couldn't ask for a better start.
They do get both bounty runes, fortunately, on Adfinim, but unfortunately, they do lose their Templar Assassin. Really nice play there from Spartan, though, rolling in onto the Juggernaut. Almost saves TA, but EGM there with the Orb of Venom to just clean up.
Very nice, and looks like a certain EGM with a fancy gold cosmetic is going to continue to be a bit of a nuisance here, and will force Thug back a bit, so we'll continue to keep tabs there. Bottom lane, the aggro setup here, as mentioned before, allows Loda to comfortably move through the lane. Still holding on to a little bit of the last bits of that.
The courier, EGM's going for it, but nope, not able to.
We'll be coming up a bit short. Looks like the courier makes it back in a way to safety, but is something that Adfinim are going to have to continue to keep tabs on. And what about our top lane matchup? It's a Lone Druid and Darkseer one-on-one. So is this kind of a win-win for both sides?
Yep, just trade farm.
Yeah.
Bulldog is super experienced in this matchup. Probably the most experienced person in all of Dota for one of these. He usually tends to actually block he blocks his pull camp constantly with his bear to make sure the Darkseer can accelerate his farm with that. But now Witch Doctor does get gone on bottom.
Yep.
You have the spin.
Okay, jump on forward. Madara needs another right click, but
Spartan
is not going to be able to get there. But Spartan is the one who's caught out. Oh, Loda tries to eat through the tree, but maybe next time is there to kind of put him in check. And Spartan, whew. Barely able to make it away, will be forced to buy the TP and head right back to base. Very close. Too close to comfort there for Adfinim, and even close for comfort for Ake, but it looks like he will be able to pick up a salve and heal himself right back up.
EGM just bullying maybe next time.
Yeah, he is just a nuisance, but dropping down the sentry here knows that he's going to be doing this uncovered.
is now going to try to be a bit of a problem here for Madara if possible. How's our mid lane matchup going here? S4 is 10-0, TA about the same, so far so good for both sides. Is that as expected, or is this just repercussions from that first blood?
It's a little bit of repercussions, but also S4 is, like we've been saying, they have their signature heroes.
Yeah.
On the side of Alliance, and they're super experienced in these matchups. Like, S4 goes for the Empower level 1, so he can deal with them, and Ake, a bit out of position, might get caught out, but no, beautiful cast bouncing through, and now they're turning it onto Spartan, and he's going to go down.
That slow of the Cloud 2 certainly helps, and the Blade Fury will help clean things up. The man-made rock will crumble down to the earth once more, and now they're going to look for a follow-up play. There's a new Cloud, silenced up Madara. Looks like he will be able to find a getaway and time walk out from trouble, and there it goes. EGM, though, still hunting around here. Spartan will help come out of the trouble by cutting down or rolling down those trees. And he'll head right back into the lane. But this is obviously very frustrating for Madara. You know, typically he gets these kind of lane setups where he has like a free Slark bit of farm or anything. In this situation, he is definitely continued to be put in check by Alliance.
Yeah. The one nice thing for Skylark is that he is on the Radiant side. So he's able to... he's able to just double stack the big camp over and over and just get a little bit of extra farm over Bulldog. So I think that he should actually maybe pull out of this lane just a little bit ahead of Bulldog.
That's good, because we know Darkseer really needs those frickin' levels in farm. Get that mech online and get enough farm to build up your wall and some points into that vacuum before he can really be a team participator. So he'll have the time to kind of build up and might be one of the biggest farmers in this game because of the laning situation. So that said... you know, Spartan as well. Typically with your Earth Spirit, you'd love to be able to kind of roam around and find some kill potential maybe towards the mid lane. And I like that cute little play. Spartan rolls right in and is able to snag up the regen rune right under the nose of EGM, who had been waiting for it.
Yep.
And now they round back. They have the vision for EGM. They lead it in with an early boulder smash, but they have the dust as a follow-up. There's going to be the roll. There's going to be the kill. At Venom, get themselves on the board.
Yep, Courier delivers that much-needed regen from Madara now. And he's doing quite well for himself. 19-3 CS to Lotus, 16-2. It's very rare that you see the supports right now, and even like the 5-minute mark, all basically have zero CS. Because we're not really used to seeing Tri versus Tri lane. It's something of the past. And Alliance is kind of bringing that back.
Yeah, especially in these playoff games, too. They've definitely been ramping up a lot of the aggro lane play, and now you see a team like FNM forced to respond in what was a bit of a throwback here. So,
yep, EGM has eyes on Spartan. Spartan looks like he wants to kind of make a play on the mid lane, but...
can they S4 maybe help coax him into a bit of an awkward position? Looks like roll back, and oh, they actually coaxed in EGM under a sentry ward, and they'll make the go for that, but S4 is there to help bail him out as he will blink strike up to the high ground, and all the wonderful benefits of being a Ricky, something that you don't get with your typical bounty hunter.
Yeah. I had actually originally thought when the game had started was that they were going to just do a straight-up dual lane with the Lion Juggernaut. Maybe that was their plan until the tri-lane came out, and having the Earth Spirit play around mid...
oh, charge back! Nicely done from S4. I'm sure he's had that done many a time in all the history of his mid lane Magnus, but this time Thug will be able to make it away. A very cute play, though, in setup.
RP blown, though, and he ends up surviving, so... but yeah, like I was mentioning, I thought that they were going to have Earth Spirit sitting on mid and just constantly stacking Ancients while playing around that mid lane, but now it does look like that's what he wants to do. Going toward that top rune.
Yep.
Oh, wow, he's just walking into
it. Hey, everybody,
oh,
how's
goodness.
It going? Mind if I just walk in and try to take it? Well, he is checked right against the wall. It's like hockey here. He does roll. Cute little play. Gets him up and over the high ground and towards Grandma's house. He's going to try to walk himself away from this, but EGM...
why'd he turn around?
I don't know. That might have been a bit of a slip-up, and EGM seems to have the move speed on him, and he gets it right by the tower. He goes down. A valiant effort to make it away. Who knows? Maybe if he didn't stutter step, he might have been able to make it to safety. But
I think he would have actually lived if he didn't stutter step.
Unfortunately, though, he did. And with that stub of the toe, he loses his life, and Alliance will now pull ahead 3-1.
Yep. Still, though, not too shabby for Advenom. The CS, they're leading a bit in the CS. We do see the Void farming much better, actually, than Loda is.
Well, a bit of a reset will happen here for Advenom as Spartan just kind of is delegated to kind of building up these stacks. Obviously, an important co-play here when you have that TA on your team, but Alliance already also ahead of the page. They do have that ward nearby to kind of scout out anyone flirting in that area, but they can't exactly see who is doing the stack or how many stacks are there, but I'm sure it's something that they'll be keeping tabs on soon enough. Both teams have actually a couple of ancient stacks built up here. Good stack farming from both sides.
Lone Druid got his Midas up. Raindrop as well. Pretty much the standard that we do see. Bottom lane, Lota getting gone on.
That's a Chrono.
They have a Chrono.
Yep, and they make their move. Ake's there, though. The Coconut slows him down, but it's not close enough to get the bounce play here.
No bashes.
No bashes, and Lota's not enough damage to bring down the Swordsmith.
And
so
mid lane, they get another RP off, and they do bring him down. They bring down the Earth Spirit this time. Oh, Thug might get a trade kill.
He's
the
trying, but the freaking Cloud comes out, and he can't get his way through it, and it turns into a double kill for EGM. Couldn't ask for anything better if you're Alliance. They avoid the trouble in the bottom lane and end up walking away with two kills simultaneously in the mid lane, and they might even get more possibly. They look for something in the bottom lane, but it's just to force the Madara time walk out. Here comes Spartan for a response, but it's a bit far out of reach, and it'll be coming up short there. Looking like another game where possibly Advenom could be struggling a bit in this laning phase, and I don't know how forgiving their lineup is if it doesn't go too successful.
Yep. They're still farming very well, and it's only like a 1,500 gold lead for Alliance. They just need to make sure that they stack up those Ancients constantly for the TA so that they can accelerate his farm. But right now, they're still doing just fine. You know, it's a few kills, but they shouldn't be feeling down on themselves at all.
Let's say Thug is able to kind of find his way back, build up these stacks, and farm up. Is it in his best interest to go straight for your damage buildup and get the Deso sooner than later? Or do you think he might have to consider other options or maybe something a bit more defensive?
He sometimes goes for that blink, the blink first, and then into the Deso later, but we'll probably see him pick up the Blightstone first and then make the decision of how he feels his farm is going. If he gets enough ancient stacks, he might go for the Deso. If he doesn't, then he might just go for the Blink Dagger.
Maybe next time did pull off a stack there and had to walk through an OBS on the side of Alliance. So they obviously know that there's stacks happening over there. Maybe they don't know how many, but it is something they are going to be aware of. Meanwhile, top lane, the biggest net worth in the game right now is the Mighty Bulldog. And he continues his casual grind, something I'm sure he's done many a time in his Dota life. Midas already online, but really waiting to get that Radiance before he can take it to the next level.
Yeah, and we do have Madara going for that Vanguard build. The one that we've, you know, the Wagga build that everybody says the Vanguard Radiance. It might not be that this time. We have been seeing a rise in popularity of the Vanguard Echo Saber.
Oh, yeah. I remember, I don't know if it was the first one to do it, but, you know, Bulldog was one of the first people I saw do it in a game. I thought it was very interesting and ended up being quite valuable, so. And then after that, I know Moon Meander adopted it a few times. Not sure who's the real innovator there, but it's definitely been a pleasant surprise, and it's worked out pretty nicely for many Faceless Voids in the past. We'll just have to see what flavor Madara does prefer here.
Yeah, makes you super tanky. With the Echo Saber, you have like 1,500 plus life with Treads, Echo Saber, and a Vanguard.
Oh, yeah. He will be definitely very, very tough to bring down, and for now has kind of a free lane to work with. It looks like Bulldog is actually going to be the one to take the stacks here.
That's and cute.
Yeah, he gets to ramp up towards his Radiance even faster. Meanwhile, mid lane, EGM pops out the smoke screen here for maybe next time, but as the trap is sprung here from Thug, they might be forced to step back and away. Shockwave will fly from S4, still has the RP, but now a Chrono flies out from Madara here, and they're kind of a bit all over the place. EGM will end up going down, even though the Chrono wasn't its best, but they get what they want, and I don't know. Hard commitment for support, but obviously a very thirsty Advenem will get their kill.
Yeah, Bulldog, though, able to clear up that Ancient. And I saw an interaction that I didn't know happened. So his Spirit Bear was empowered, and he resummoned it, and the new resummoned Bear had Empower.
Also had Empower.
Yes, so that was an interesting little thing. I didn't really know that interaction worked that way. Noob analyst.
Well, I mean, how often have we been seeing Lone Druid Magnus games, you know? So
yeah.
Can't really fault you on that. Come on. I don't know if Twitch chat would be forgiving, though, so sorry, buddy.
Nope, I don't forgive myself either. It's okay.
So hard on yourself. Here's Thug, though, back in the grind, and it looks like straight to Deso for him, potentially, Fog. He's got the Blightstone and the Hammer paired up, and just about 1,000 gold away from being able to clean the Deso up altogether.
Yeah, he was able to freely clear those Ancients up without the pressure of the Ricky or from anyone from Alliance, so. And he does feel like they do need the damage, and I would agree with him.
Ooh, looks like Alliance heading towards this top lane. Skylark, though, a bit on edge, waits way back behind this tier 2 while he still has a fresh tier 1 way up here at the top, knows that trouble is potentially a brewing. Saw maybe the ship from S4 and didn't see him show up onto the ward here. And oh, man, it looks like maybe next time was able to cross paths with EGM there. Blast him with the finger, and the Ricky goes down.
Alrighty then. He was dewarding, and he's just like, oh, a Ricky. All right,
free money.
Stun, finger. Ricky is very innately squishy, especially because he also did go for that phase boot build, which we've been seeing as well quite a lot lately. So, yeah, very nice pickup there for the line and much-needed money. Like, thank you. You just paid for my sentries and my wards.
And he might get more money soon here. Look like Advinim were making a push towards this bottom lane to breach and take down this tier one.
They've got their five-man timing now, though. They've got the mech finished up. Yep. They're getting close to like a few other items. So right now they can take this tower. I wouldn't be surprised if we see them make a move all around the map to take the rest of the tier ones very soon. Oh, I thought missed the last hit on the tower there. Unfortunate.
Well, one step towards breaching those towers down, but you're right. I mean, taking that last hit would have helped him get that desolate just that much faster, but we'll be forced to wait in the meantime.
Bulldog getting close to that relic, 400 away.
Yeah, he is
doing very well for himself.
He's turning into a monster fast. So we'll have to see what the response play will be here from Advinim. And it looks like top lane will be their potentially next objective while they still leave Madara here down at the bottom. Still haven't seen any sort of inkling as far as what his next buildup is.
Yeah, he just went for the Ring of Akilla for now. And then he's just probably waiting to decide. Maybe he'll just pick up the treads. Just because he doesn't really have the item slots to drop anything just yet.
And for the rest of them, it looks like they'll just kind of get back into their grind. They do have Spartan now at level 6, so they do have Magnetize to play with, and just kind of goes along with, the, as you mentioned, their five-man play. So
yeah, and we see that Alliance was actually feeling quite pressured there in farming in that bottom lane. They actually scan just below where Bulldog is farming, but they don't read the play from Advinim properly there. Advinim is making a different move, and S4 does finish up that Blink Dagger now. So he has Blink RP online and level 3 in power, so it's really going to boost up his buddy Loda and Bulldog.
Yep, and obviously can be their head initiator here and kind of playmaker if they want to make any sort of setup. But we'll have to be careful. You never know. You could end up jumping yourself into a potential, you know, geometric grip from Earth Spirit, and we'll have to see. You look at the lineups now, and it becomes pretty apparent that for a lot of these fights, it comes down to some serious execution plays.
Here's the smoke. They're going for Skylark in the top lane. Advinim is not going to be ready for this.
Let's see. Skylark, oh, he's still lingering around. This seems to be an easy pickoff. He waits once, waits twice. Will be able to get the skewer all the way back. It's straight into his smoke screen here. Tricks of the trade will help clean that one up. Spartan shows up with a boulder smash, but could find himself in quick trouble. Gets the magnetize off first, but will only be a little bit of lingering magic damage. Can Madara get in and find some sort of double man chrono to help clean things up? Ooh, he's kind of cut between two. Blind man stun is going to be off the mark. Madara jumps through, but still can't find Loda. Moves through. Is that a cat ward? Still can't find him. Turns the corner, walks back and away, and it looks like Alliance have been able to slip totally away from this.
Yeah,
and eventually,
another one.
Yeah, they get their own re-engagement. Beautiful skewer back into a Blade Fury. Gets one, almost gets two. Madara will be able to time walk away to get a lot of that HP back, but he will survive. Alliance, they'll walk away with two kills all day.
Man, and Advinim, I don't even feel like they should have TP'd. Like, they should have just gone for their own split push, because as soon as he gets gone on, he was already dead. And now Thug as well might get caught out.
Oh no, he's running back and away. Does have that safe fresh deso, but it looks like, yeah, he will be good.
And but yeah, instead of just giving up a single kill on the Darkseer, they end up giving up three kills to Alliance because of their reactionary play rather than just going with their own inner feeling. Again, Alliance dictating the pace of this game currently.
And that is the Alliance way for most of the games.
And Bulldog is enormous.
He just got that Radiance.
He's got 600 gold too. He's got Radiance, he's got his raindrops, he's got Midas, he's got Bassy, he's got a Ring of Regen 2 on top of all that, and 600 gold. This guy is huge. Level 14 going on level 15 at 16 minutes and 30 seconds. That is
certainly helps.
Extremely impressive.
Swing and a miss on the dust, it looks like, trying to get a hold of EGM, but he was actually more towards the mid lane right behind that tier 1. So Advinim will have to miss the mark on that one. And it feels like a bit of an awkward start here for them. Wait a bit of a hiccup, but here we go. Boulder smash will be off the mark. Not the ideal start. While it's Alliance who are kind of propping themselves up. There's no RP yet. Still need about 20 seconds. They could just stall things out here. This tier one, though, is set to fall. I don't know how the timing's going to work here. Will they sweep in for the deny? Will Adfinim look to jump? Madar is in position. He's waiting. He's got that chrono in his pocket. Just in case there's a response from Alliance, which it doesn't seem to be yet, but now comes Bulldog. Will they do anything about it here?
Here we go. RP online.
He's waiting.
Three together.
Boom!
Gets all three.
Got him! Beautifully done. Shockwave.
Big
Blade
chrono,
Fury.
Though.
Chrono as the counterplay from Madara is respectable and nice, but do they have the damage to clear it up? It does not look like it. It looks like Alliance are going to get the better of this one. They take down three. They'll only lose EGM, and now it's maybe next time a man on the run gets the hex off while Madara, eating the death ward, will be forced to time walk back it away. They are able to catch up with that lion and finish him off. It's a double kill for Bulldog. Alliance take four names and only lose one. Nice.
Perfect positioning there. The Invis rune as well, more than ideal. Gets a three-man RP. The chrono does catch on almost four heroes from Alliance, but there's no damage, there's no follow-up. It's pretty much a defensive chrono, and it doesn't even actually end up saving any of his buddies anyway. So completely wasted by Adfinim, and they are starting to fall heavily behind in this game.
Alliance, I wouldn't be surprised. Could double back, go right for the Roche if they really wanted to here. Just continuing to do Alliance things where they get these pickoffs and follow it up with quick objectives, really kind of accelerating the pace of this game and not allowing Adfinim to be able to fall back. But unlike the last game, Fog, where they had that tricore and maybe potential to scale into the late game, this one I would not be nearly as confident with. TA should be really beginning her snowball by now, and she's only 1-3. And for your Faceless Void, he requires quite the buildup if you want to see him as a real hard hitter and damage dealer in the late game.
Yeah, it's not looking good for the Greek boys right now. They are very heavily far behind, and they're playing into a lineup that scales not even just like exponentially, but in more of a factor than that on the side of Alliance, where they have three heroes that benefit heavily from Empower with a max Empower.
Adfinim are coming by here. Alliance haven't been able to finish the roast. Well, quick burst from the TA will be able to finish off Ake. Alliance could be in a bit of an awkward position here.
RP on the ready, though.
Yep, and Chrono is not. So roll forward. Spartan dishes up the Magnetize between two, gets the Boulder Smash off. That will prevent S4 from being able to be a good blinking position. Walks through. Magnetize will reset. And they're trying their best to be able to get at least EGM bursted down. He's dropping every stone he can to be able to get it done. That, connected through, almost got EGM, but it's not going to be enough. Oh, Vacuum will bring Bulldog up and right on top of a wall up and above. The Chrono locks
Chrono's
him down.
Just his teammate.
Oh, no. Just locking the Bulldog, and of course, the maybe next time Lion's not going to be enough, but with Bulldog still trapped on the high ground, Madara joins him, and he's just in a continuous battle with himself.
Oh, instant Hex by maybe next time.
But that Hex stops anything from having as a follow-up from Alliance. They still can't get him down. They finally will finish him off. It is going to be Darkseer who gets the credit because of the wall. Turns into a 2-for-1, man. Adfinim doing their damnedest to keep him alive, but there's going to be the burst. They finally finish out the Lion, and here comes Spartan back for round number two. Boulder Smash Silence onto S4. Madara leaps in for the follow-up play. Can they stop him from making it out? He's just going to commit the RP.
He's going to die anyway.
And boom!
Holy
They'll
crap.
Be able to finish him off.
The
what
Kester
a wonderful
curse is real.
Comeback here from Adfinim. And look at this. They'll sweep in to hopefully get the finish. But look at this. EGM, they don't have a sentry. Oh, God. He's got to be careful. The Psyblade damage. Oh, they finish
oh my
him
God,
off anyways.
They
tied the Roche Pit. Oh, no.
Oh, my God. This is unbelievable.
Oh, no.
That was... They're back. They're back in this game. They're completely back in this game.
That just put the game... Back even.
I just said, looking rough for the Greek boys, and they hear me, and they're like, no, we're going to take this game back right now. And Thug gets beautiful initiations off. He jumps in, takes out Ake in the beginning of that fight. Ake literally walked into that fight in the first place,
yep.
Died. The whole fight happened. He respawned, walked, got two-shotted again. So that is the saddest witch doctor on the planet right now, but... Beautiful plays coming out from Adfinim. Even Spartan there, he threw his life away just to keep that RP or keep the Magnetize flowing, keep it going onto S4. So S4 is not able to find the positioning because he's not able to blink at all to get any RPs. And then afterwards, they get a nice vacuum up on the high ground for of the Lone Druid. And S4 tries to get a blink RP off to get, I think it was 2 or 3 man RP. And maybe next time actually had vision of him, gets the instant hex off. And, yep, they take the fight, take the Roche, and then, of course, that splash kill. I mean, We're going to be seeing clips of that for a bit.
Absolutely. Okay, Spartan. All right. Tried to sidestep a bit. S4 looking for the setup with the Skira. Low says, I'm just going to R-click him. And the Omni Slash is there. They'll take down the Ear Spirit and follow it up with a plus one on the tower. Alliance determined to take back the initiative they had set for themselves in the laning stage. But my God, Advent have really opened things up now in the mid game. And with their advantage, they are continuing their assault top lane. They'll pressure in for this tier two. Alliance looking for a trade on the bottom lane.
You know what's absurd, too? That Chrono only hit his teammates in the last fight, and they won the engagement so hard.
And even kind of saved Bulldog for a bit. He didn't have to worry about the wall there for the meantime. But yeah imagine how much better it would have gone, even with the good Chrono.
They all carried their weight in that fight in a way, but Spartan, he was really he was just that sacrificial lamb. It was god-tier plays by him there.
Yeah. And Alliance will be able to also clean up that bottom tier two. So that is a kill on Spartan and two towers for Alliance. Not too shabby for a recovery play in their economy after a very rough Roche situation for them. But now this game, it's a whole new game now.
Wow.
That's for sure.
And okay. Lota still goes for Battle Fury even though he has Empower. So I guess he just wants to be able to emphasize in pushing lanes out.
Somebody
better.
Get this guy a bra. That's a lot of cleavage right there. That's for sure. I don't know. I mean, Omni Slash will definitely do a serious number.
Good.
You like that?
I like that one.
Yeah,
that
I tried. Thanks, man.
Yeah, the Omni Slash will be obviously enhanced a bit if people are obviously around the area from the Empower and the Battle Fury combo for the cleave. But stacking up cleaves is not something we tend to see happen too often. But I could understand him wanting to just make sure that they force the lanes out constantly. But it is a bit of a weird item decision because he's kind of squishy now rather than going for like, what do we say? Usually people go like SNY, Scotty, or maybe even like something else like in between that, like the defusal.
Sometimes that early Vanguard, yeah.
Yeah, that's like what we tend to see, especially if it's like with a mag. You're not really used to seeing that Battle Fury build. But either way, accelerates his farm.
Yep.
Lets him pick up speed.
Mm-hmm. And just based on that fight. Recognizing that they might have to pump the brakes a bit on being able to take team fights and will just do their alliance thing and take in the farm game and hope that they just take it faster. Which, you know what? They have the tools to take farm a lot faster. You got that Lone Druid Radiance. You now got that Battle Fury on the jug. They can play with the clock a bit. Advent though say, we've just taken the initiative. We've taken the advantage. We don't want to let go. Let's just keep this pace up and continue fighting when our ultimates are up and when our team fight's good to go.
Oh, they're running into the enemy jungle right now.
Okay. Oh, down and below.
They know that
okay.
S4 is there.
S4. Oh, he eats a shockwave, but S4 will be able to get the blink and a skewer for extra safety distance straight to the TP. Oh, my God. Oh, okay. I would say Valiant Chrono could have been there, but obviously just out of vision.
Adara went for the Manta build that we've been seeing, so Manta, maybe even Defusal after that. I don't know if he has the item slots to go for that, but it is definitely a possibility.
Also, speaking of Defusals, by the way, EGM. Pretty close to his, if not close to done. I thought I saw him have two Blade of Alacrities before.
He put it back at base. He was carrying around some wards, I'm pretty sure.
All right, fair enough. But yeah, he's getting pretty close to his. But here comes Advenom now. The Greeks making the way down from the northern front of this base here. Alliance, for the first time in quite a while, actually going to have to be on their high ground defense here.
And finally, Advenom is able to get all these wards out. After they take that big Roche engagement and everything, they put down three wards defensively, or three wards into the secret shop area, and then another ward now up in that top side after they took that tower. So good objective wards coming out by them.
And it looks like that might be the end of the top lane push here for Advenom. At least for now. It looks like they'll step back and away. Lota was pressuring this bottom lane, so it forced out the rotation here, at least from Madara. So Alliance, this is what they do best, though. You know, it's something that Ben was also talking about a lot when I was casting with him in the Alliance game we casted previously. It's just Alliance are just so good at being able to dictate their pace, man.
Yeah.
If they don't want to take a fight, they won't take a fight. They're very good at manipulating the map and forcing their opponents up and down and away and playing that cat and mouse game.
We touched on it a bit this game, but last game was the one where more so it was like, they dictated the whole flow of the game. This one, they were dictating the whole flow until that Roche engagement.
Yeah, that's where things can go wrong for Alliance is just when just crazy chaotic. It's like, wait, we were supposed to get this Roche scot-free, and then the Greeks show up, they're ready to toga party or whatever, and Alliance just didn't have their party hats on, I guess. I don't know. So they'll be able to recover, though, and you can see it in the graph, where Advenom got that spike back when they're just playing the stagnant farm game. That's where Alliance are better. So they are just slowly accumulating the economy game back to where it once was.
Yep.
So that's not good for Advenom.
Battle Fury jug with Empower.
Yeah.
Pushes lanes down in like two swings. Bulldog as well. Empowered Bear kills it in like little to no time. And it does look like Bulldog is pretty much finished up with his AC. He's gonna be picking it up from the fountain on his bear, grabs it.
Yep.
So he's got the Vlad, the AC, and the Radiance at like 26 minutes. This has to be like some kind of record, but I say that, but this tends to be the same thing that we see happen all the time from Bulldog.
Yeah, it's a Bulldog standard almost at this point. Jump in from Thug, but Loda gets off the Blade Fury TP and will not be shot down whatsoever. And back at mid lane, EGM.
Mid lane.
Yeah, he's got that roll though. Plenty of ways to be able to make it away from any one-on-one engagement when you're a spirit. Kick him away, roll away. He's a hard one to take down once he gets out of that smoke screen.
Yeah, EGM doesn't really have like solo kill potential, except maybe on the Lion, because he does have that defusal and the max blink strike.
Yep.
But no big points.
He's still
dagger yet.
Very frail. I mean, 940 life. Yep. So has to be careful. Something like Magnetize, getting caught by too many like Iron Shell damage, walking through a wall in these team fights, he could be very susceptible to being bursted down.
Smoke by Alliance. Thug, it might just walk directly into this.
Oh, here
they
come.
It, and it's going to be Spartan who gets caught.
Swing and a miss on the skier, but it doesn't matter.
That's fine.
It's Spartan who just gets bursted down fast.
That's actually so much better than the TA dying, obviously.
Oh, of course. He'll tank the gank.
Yep, tanks the gank, and it's not really in too awful of a position. Sure, Alliance is like right outside their gates, but still, beating on the high ground is always scary.
And because Alliance are only going to be able to snag up the one support, they'll just kind of walk back and begin to take away all that farm from Advenim in their own woods here. And that forces Advenim to, again, bunk up, put in that buddy-buddy system, hang inside the safety of their home. And, you know, this is not the game they want to be playing right now. You can't go against Alliance in just a farming game.
No.
You have to find a way to take initiative, find pickoffs or something, do more of this outside-the-box play, catch out Alliance from behind the backs or something.
Yeah, and you know Alliance, like with the way they just did that play, you know Alliance can tell that they're out farming Advenim. They just were like, you know what, we don't need to put any risk with this. We just put down a ward, get some vision of their movements, and we don't need to really rush anything. We feel very comfortable. We know we're out farming them.
Ooh, dust, but it's EGM who just barely makes it away here. It crossed over that sentry. They knew he was around, but were not able to get around in time to spot him out. Would have only just been a simple Ricky takedown nonetheless, but even there, you know, Alliance proved to be very difficult to get a hold of, and now he has a gem. So vision advantage could be a problem here for the Greeks soon enough.
Yep. Thug, however, is progressing very well with his items, and he's going the perfect item build. So he has the Blink, he has the Deso, BKB, and now next MKB, of course, not only for that Radiance miss, but of course, smoke screen miss rate that is
there. Yeah, absolutely.
And yeah, Loda is going to be going for that Eye of Scotty build that we do tend to see.
He's going to be very stat heavy, and very Roche. Tanky.
And Roche respawns. No TA trap in the pit, though, by Thug.
Yeah, he's way up here in the top lane, too, so he won't even be close. And after he pushes this, might need to consider heading down to the southern part of this map to be by his team, because that was the last time we did see the big advantage for Advenim was being able to have that confrontation play against Alliance in the previous Roche. So I'm sure they want to be able to go. I mean, that's it. I mean, Roche is one of those few times where they know where Alliance could be and actually together and not really able to kind of be able to disengage. So they need to make it count.
Yep. MKB finished up at the same time that Lotus should be finishing up his Eye of Scotty as well.
Smoke here, it looks like.
And Bulldog has a full basher as well. Oh my god, he's so farmed.
He's a big boy.
Gets a new item every 3 minutes.
Yeah. Okay. Smoke on one side. Magnus picks up a smoke on the other here. Okay. Advenim on the move.
We're going to have a smoke.
Raiding down the mid lane.
Oh,
maybe next time leaves out the front, but he didn't even have a blink.
Loda
he
here.
Got spotted. Loda pulls back. Oh, but there's going to be the jump. Madara. Oh, he got roared a bit. He's out of position here. And can't find the commitment yet for the Chrono. Does
oh, he
go!
Gets, he gets
catches
S4.
Two! S4 and Bulldog. They decide to go for Bulldog instead. Can they burst him down in time? He's taking a lot of damage, but they can't finish him off yet. Vacuum right under the wall. RP has the counterplay. And my god, look at the damage fly out from Loda. Ultra kill by him as he wipes out four. Oh my goodness, Alliance, say don't you dare.
All right, Battle Fury paying off instantly.
Whoa!
Yeah.
He just sliced right
double,
through him.
Double cleave on an RP.
Oh.
Everyone literally just
he slashes.
Died
he dashes. That's like an infomercial right there. That was crazy. For $49.99, you can also have this Battle Fury cleave play. Jesus Christ.
That was pretty ridiculous how fast they actually dropped. And they ended up getting a pretty decent chrono, but it was just his team wasn't near them. His team wasn't close enough, and they weren't able to get S4 in a crappier position, so his team was able to burst him down. S4 just waits patiently. They end up vacuuming into a pretty decent position to get the RP, even though there was a lot of illusions there, which got cleaved down. It didn't matter. Everyone on the side of AdVenom basically died instantly.
Mega hype fight, though, and now Alliance are going to be able to just put their assault in.
No Chrono, no Earth Spirit Ultimate.
Nah.
All they have is Lion
Finger. No wall, nothing. All of their true high ground defense potential is just gone, and this could be racks for Alliance, and one game away from at
two
least securing
even.
Wild card here at TI, securing at least a trip to Seattle. It looks like they'll take their racks and they'll quickly walk back and away here. Madara jumps right in. Smokescreen already set up. There's going to be the silence, though. Keeps him safe. Boulder Smash forward. Locks Loda, but very hesitant at AdVenom, knowing that they are a bit short on ammunition as far as what ultimates they can work with here. There's going to be the Magnetize from Spartan. Loda could be going down, but that would be just, of course, his Aegis. Meanwhile, they set scores. Poor Ake, who had been shoved into a Hurt Locker the most of this game, will be going down once more. Nice Boulder Smash. Vacuum Wall combo, but really not everything. Okay,
oh,
there's a chrono. Big chrono
no
catch.
No damage, though.
But
no follow-up.
Yeah, they can't get the follow for Loda, and the Bear is able to isolate Thug and keep him back in at bay. So Alliance are going to be good. And now they'll re-engage. Skewer a bit off the mark, but they'll finally finish off the Lion, and they're going to be down a man now. And Alliance can just move in for a second set of racks, and down south they go.
Yeah, now their ultimates are up. They have the Omni Slash with the Empower and the Battle Fury. They have the Magnus with the RP. And they're just getting a lot of economy from this, too. They're all getting super rich from taking out these buildings and these racks.
Oh, man. Nice little Blade Fury will avoid the stun, but once Loda hits that R button, it
there
could
it
be
is.
Disaster.
Boom,
boom, boom, boom, boom. Yeah, see you later.
Yep.
And that will be game. Alliance move on to the next round. They will be going to Seattle, at least in the wild card, but they have made it into the finals of this playoff. Wonderful showing.
We actually had some really cool team fights in this
game.
Yeah,
that was awesome.
It did seem like it was a bit one-sided, but still, there was like two or three team fights in this game which were actually beautiful to watch, and just in the way that they ended up happening. Of course, Alliance prevails, picking a very safe and standard lineup. The only thing that was kind of a bit of a changeup was the Rikimaru, in my opinion, but overall, the theme of what they wanted to do and the pace that they wanted, it fits their style, it fits everything they wanted to do, and it works.
It works. Alliance will continue to play their game. A wonderful showing by them. Props to AdVenom. A hell of a fight. A wonderful Roche fight there in that game number two. They're down, but they're not out. They go into the lower bracket now to fight on to another day. They'll still need to be able to pull out another one if they want to be able to be contenders for the wild card at least. We'll continue to watch their journey, but again, props to Alliance. They take this win, and we'll move on. And Fogg, I think that concludes it for you today. It's been a pleasure.
I will be on the panel after this.
We'll look forward to that. So check out Fogg on the panel coming up soon.
Please
I'm going to be joining Merlini next for the next matchup and then before the grand finals. So I'm getting hyped up. Let's cut to a break and we'll prepare for our next series.